I invite you now to stand and join us as we're singing praises to our Lord.
Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad. Let the people of God sing His praise all over the land. Everyone in the valley, come and lift your voice. All those on the mountainside, be glad and shout for joy. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, rise up and praise Him. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad. Let the people of God sing His praise all over the land. Everyone in the valley, lift your voice. All those on the mountains, I'll be glad and shout for joy. Rise up and praise Him. He deserves our love. Rise up and praise Him. Worship the Holy One with all your heart, your soul, with all your mind. Rise up and praise Him. Rise up and praise Him. Rise up and
us. If we run to Him, He will run to us. If we lift our hands, He will lift us up. On a praise His name, all His saints are God. Oh, sing for joy to God our strength. Oh, sing for joy.
I will listen. pray for the offering as the ushers come forward. Dear Lord, I thank you for this morning and the people here who could make it. And I ask that you just bless these gifts as we give back to you what you've given to us. I pray all this in your name. Amen. You can take a seat.
You are still my first love, and all I am is yours. You are still my anchor, forever I'm secure. You are still my first love.
Say that when my wife wanted to sing that song, I heard it first and I thought, man, I don't know. That just doesn't sound like a song I'd want to sing. And when those words passed through my lips, when I told Jesus that I loved him, that changed the song for me. And I heard first hear the lyric, oh my soul, rejoice. And I thought, that doesn't fit. But then you sing the other part first, that you do love him, and suddenly the next part fits. Anyways, thank you for letting me share that with you. I'd invite you to stand with us. We're going to invite the Lord to reign over us, in us. And hopefully you'll be able to do that with a true heart.
Follow along with me. I'm going to be reading 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8. It says, love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away.
I'm forgiven because you are forsaken. I'm accepted. You are condemned. I'm alive and well. Spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven. Because you are forsaken. Thank you.
see
you.
We've been going through the book of James, and we're going to continue with that this morning. We come to a passage in the scriptures here in James chapter 2. Last week, we were in the first part of chapter 2, and we talked about discrimination there and how we're not supposed to practice the sin of discrimination. We've been talking about what persevering faith looks like, as James has talked about trials and testing and what true religion looks like. And so we're getting the feel here that this is not just something that we talk about. This is not just something that we have in our minds. This is something that we do, okay? And so as we come to this passage in James chapter 2, it's a passage about our faith and the connection between our faith and works. And it's a passage that has been one that's a challenge for the church throughout church history. If you read the commentators, you'll find that there are so many nuances, if you will, or disagreements about what this passage actually says there. So much so that even Martin Luther, whose whole idea was struggling with how does one have the righteousness of God, and came to the understanding based on Romans chapter 1:17 that the righteousness of God is something that is bestowed upon us by God. It's by grace. We are saved. And it's, you know, what comes out of the Reformation era is this whole idea about it's by faith alone, right? By grace alone. And so so when we come to this passage here, Martin Luther had such a problem with the whole book of James, he just threw it out, you know? He said, I don't think it really belongs in the Bible. And he's just a man. He was a very learned person, for sure, but even the most learned can make mistakes, right? And so I say that because we shouldn't be too hard on Martin Luther, because there's a lot of things in Scripture that sometimes we have a problem with, and so we just say, I'm just not going to deal with that, right? I mean, it's not right to do. It's wrong to do. No, but sometimes that's how we deal with it. I don't really know what to do with that. Is that telling me that I really need to change my life? And then we start to say, I'm not ready to do that. And so we just kind of push it aside. But as we look in Scripture this morning here, we're going to see the idea about faith, and it's faith that is alive, is that we live by faith to show that our faith is alive. We live by faith to show that our faith is alive. And I want to encourage you to live by faith, to show your faith is alive. So turn with me to James chapter 2, starting in verse 14, which is where we left off last week, after verse 13, and we'll read to the end of the chapter, okay? Excuse me. It says this: What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way, was not also Rahab, the prostitute, justified by works when she received the messenger and sent them out, received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. And this is the word of the Lord. So as we're reading through it, you can see why there's some struggle in there. You can see why Martin Luther had some difficulty with this passage, because on the surface it seems to say that something contrary to maybe what we read about in the book of Romans, what the Apostle Paul talks about. And we'll get into that here in the sermon a little bit later on. I'm not going to address it right now, but when we get to it, we will get to it, okay? So the first thing here is, as we're going through this passage here, we're talking about the idea of living by faith to show that our faith is alive. And so I want to kind of give you 3 points here. And the idea is that faith that is alive is something, okay? And the first point is faith that is alive takes action, okay? That's the first point there. Faith that is alive takes action. And we're trying to adjust this, and I know the power is working. Okay, thank you if you're helping me. I appreciate that. Faith that is alive takes action. So that's the first idea. You know, James, is, like I said, has been talking about, as we've been reading through this and studying through it, is the idea that if we have a real, genuine faith, that there's going to be some sort of outworking of that faith. It's impossible to believe something without acting on it. Okay? So, for instance, if the doctor tells you that this medicine will make you well, if you don't believe the doctor and you don't believe the medicine will make you well, you won't take the medicine. If you believe the medicine will make you well, you will take the medicine. It's very simple like that. If your parents tell you drink your soup because it's good for you, right? You might not like soup, but you might believe your parents that it's good for you, and so you drink it, right? Or they make you do it, right, when you were younger. Eat your vegetables, it's good for you. See, the problem with that is we get a little bit of knowledge and we start to say, well, it's not that good for me. I can eat stuff that I like and not stuff that I don't like, and that would be just as good for me, wouldn't it? And so we're always trying to work all of that out. But when we talk about here with the scriptures is telling us here about, genuine faith, is that you can't say you believe and not have some sort of outworking of that faith. That's the idea here. So if our faith is alive, the first thing we want to see is that faith that is alive takes action. And so turn there on verses 14 through 17, and we'll get into that. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? So James talks or starts off right here, and he gives us two questions, and they're two rhetorical questions. He's not looking for an answer from anybody, because the answer is pretty obvious. He says, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? He doesn't expect an answer. He's about to give the one that's going to come up here in verses 15 through 17. And when we're talking about works, we're talking about this idea here. It comes from the Greek word ergon, okay? So if you've ever heard of ergonomics, ergonomic chairs, they're designed so that you can do work as you sit in them. That's this word here for works or for deeds, ergo or ergon. It's work, it's action or accomplishment. In the book of James, it's action that's done in obedience to God. And so as he's asking the question, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works, can that faith save him? There's no connection between his faith and his actions. And so he's asking the question, can that faith save him? The first question he's asking is kind of like, first of all, what good is it if someone says he has faith but does not have works? What good is it if you have a driver's license but you don't know how to operate a car? What good is it if you have a hunting license but you don't know how to shoot a gun? Right? It's useless to you. It doesn't have any meaning. All of this is a piece of paper that really doesn't have any content to it, because it's nothing that's actually operational in your life. James asked that question that way. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Then he asked the second question, and it's asked in such a way that the answer that is expected is negative. You know what I mean by that? You do, see? I asked that in such a way that I knew you would say yes, right? But you know how it is. It's like when your parents were yelling at you when you were younger, and they said, you didn't really think that you were going to do that, did you? And the expected answer was, no, of course not. I didn't think that way, right? It's asked in such a way that that's the expected answer, and that's the way James asks it here. Can that faith save him? Of course it can. Of course it can. That's what he's saying. He's saying that there's a faith that can save, but a faith that doesn't have any actions connected to it is not saving faith. Okay? It's not alive. Here's how we get into it. Verse 15, he gives this example here. He says, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, if somebody's poorly clothed, right, shabby clothes, as we talked about, filthy clothes, and they need food, what are you going to do for them? What are you going to do for them? They're hungry, right? You're going to give them some food, right? Give them some clothes, right? They don't have anything. But he says, so if you see someone like this, and it's not just anyone, it's the word brother or sister here, so it's someone you're actually connected to, right? If you see a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for their body, what good is that? Right? It doesn't help them at all. And he's given that example because he's saying, hey, this is what your faith without works is like. It's like somebody just kind of has some well-wishing ideas there, but nothing is going to come of it. There's not going to be any action. And so he's given that example here because he wants us to understand, he wants his readers to understand what real practical living faith looks like is something that's practical and living. Okay? It's in action. And so James is not contrasting faith and works, okay? He's not contrasting faith and works, but he's making the contrast between a faith that doesn't have any works and a faith that does have works. A faith that just seems to be empty confession and a faith that seems to have confession that works out in actions so that it's really believed in such a way that you live it out. So that's the first point there. Faith that is alive takes action. The second point is faith that is alive is inseparable from works. Okay, it's inseparable from works. Here's how we get that. We pick up here in verse 18. So James introduces this person here. It's kind of the way of doing this, they call it a diatribe, but you introduce somebody who says, well, what if somebody said this? Or what if somebody said this? And I just have to tell you, there was a theologian in the medieval time there. I think we would call them the Dark Ages. This is probably about 1000 AD. His name was Anselm of Canterbury. But he had a guy there, and he would have these discussions, and he put up an imaginary person so that he would write out he was trying to prove a point, right? So you have this imaginary dialogue that's coming in, and you build this person up to ask the questions that you want to answer. And this person's name was Bozo. Guess where we get the word from? That's where it comes out from. And so it was just asked the question. Bozo would ask the dumb question, and so it'd be clear for his Anselm to just kind of give the answer, and it'd just keep on strengthening up his argument here. James is not doing that here. He's not putting in some Bozo, but he's putting in the type of thing that people would ask or might ask based on what he just said. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works and I will show you my faith by my works. As he's here, he's saying that our confession, what we believe, has got to go beyond just something that's verbal. It has to be something that influences our behavior. Okay? It has to be something that influences our behavior. The confession has to touch our hearts and lives so that our living is consecrated as to the Lord. Holy living. You cannot prove you have faith. This is another one way of saying what he's telling here in verse 18. You cannot prove you have faith unless you have works, but because I have works, you see that I have faith. That's the idea here in verse 18. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. If you look there, there's a quotation there, and all the texts have, they know where the beginning of the quotation is, they just don't know where the end of the quotation is. The idea here is that he's saying you cannot prove you have faith unless you have works, but because I have works here, he's saying you see that I have faith. So you can, there's a way that where it shows. If you have a faith that doesn't show, then people are not really sure that you really have faith. If you have a faith that does show, it's pretty easy to show that you have faith because it shows, okay? And so that's verse 18. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Verse 19, you believe that God is one, you do well. And remember James's audience here at the beginning? He's a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ to the 12 tribes in the dispersion. Greetings. So his writing is to Jewish Christians, those who would connect themselves with this idea of the 12 tribes of Israel. And so he's going to come out here and he's going to go into Deuteronomy chapter 6, where there's this famous passage in there known as the Shema. And that's the idea that the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And so he cites this here in verse 19. You believe that God is one, you do well. Yeah, right on. You got that. That's good understanding. He's not faulting them for what they understand. He's not faulting them for making this confession. Not at all. He says, you do well. It's good. Pat yourselves on the back. Let me see you reach back and pat yourself on the back. You do that? Okay. Now here comes the stickler here. Okay. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. So what you have in your head there isn't anything unless there's some sort of action upon it. And so our faith here is not a private faith, but it has to be lived out in the world. That's what I was telling you earlier in verse 18. Our faith is, and we talked about this before, you know, we talked about true religion and what it looks like. And the reason we have to be mindful of that, because I told you, the society, the culture wants us to shutter ourselves. They want us to have a quote-unquote private faith. It's something that you believe. We don't talk about that stuff. There's a few things that are taboo, right? We're not supposed to talk about politics. And during this last election, we know why, right? Right? And then we know, well, why would you talk about religion, right? Because what happens there? Wars are started over religion. That's what people want to say. But the thing is that as Christians, when you believe something, you can't not live it out, right? If you believe that the ground holds you up, you're going to walk on it. If you have some kind of phobia that the ground cannot support your weight, you won't walk around on it. You know, so we've gone out to the river there, and it's all frozen, right? And you know, and I think it's probably dangerous. Some of you have told me that maybe I shouldn't be out that far or something like that. But we go and run around on top of the ice there. It's okay, right? They say it's about 2, 3, 4, 5 feet thick. I don't know how much it is. But you know, we went out the first year we were here, and the sun was shining, but the river was frozen over, and we were playing, and there's a spot that's out there, and you can see it's really, it's thick still, it's still thick, but it kind of was clear a little bit, you know? And so when we started walking out there, Jermaine's on the shore, and she's like, don't, she's doing all that stuff, you know? She's all worried about that. Remember, Joel? It's pretty funny. We have it on video. but, you know, if you don't believe it's going to do something, it's going to support you, then you're not going to rely upon it. And so we want to have a living faith that shows that's what it is. Because really, if that's what we rely on, that's what we do. Okay? So James gives us this example of the demons, and I think he does that because that's probably a very extreme example, right? I mean, you think about who's good and who's bad. These are the bad guys. And he says, okay, you want to talk about believing that God is one? You want to talk about your confession of faith and what you say you believe? Okay, you believe that, that's good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. It doesn't make any difference with them. And so I think James is making it clear that their belief is correct, but their actions are not, right? The belief is correct, but the actions are not. So we talk about this with people, and we say that, you know, there are some people here, their theology is right on, but there's just no outworking of that in their lives. They have intellectually, they can give it to you from the word, they can lay it all out there, and they can say, this is how it is, but you never see that in their life. And so the question is, do we really believe what we say we believe? And if we do, then what does it look like? I think one of the things that James could be saying here is that he could be saying that like demons who lack true faith, right? They have a confession, but they lack true faith. They shudder in fear of judgment. So also ought people whose verbal profession is not followed up with actions. Maybe there's room in there to shudder. Maybe there's room to think about what it is you think you believe and make sure that it's not just a passing idea. I was born in America, therefore I believe in God. You know, I've heard people tell me that. And you've also heard the thing, too, that just because you're in the garage doesn't mean that you're a car, right? Something like that, okay? So James gives this example here, and he says, but someone will say, in verse 19, you believe that God is one, you do well, even the demons believe and shudder. Verse 20 says, do you want to be shown? I'm going to this next point. Faith that is alive is faith in a living God who saves. And I'll get right to verse 20 here and make the connection here, okay? Faith that is alive is faith in a God who saves. Verse 20, here we go. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? And so when you look at that, it just says, okay, I understand there's faith without works is useless. The literal translation is faith apart from works is useless. If we take that phrase, the literal translation is the idea that when it comes to works and useless, it's a wordplay in the original language. The words are ton ergon arche. It's the idea that works doesn't work. But the first part of it is you have faith without works doesn't work, right? So it's kind of an interesting way to put it. And we translate it useless, but it literally means faith that does not work doesn't work. So you have to think about it a little bit, but it's pretty clear when you put it in its context. And so that's what he says. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart works is useless? And then he goes to Abraham. And remember the idea of Abraham is that Abraham is this father of faith. And he brings this back to a Jewish audience in particular would connect back to Abraham. They're going to connect back to Abraham and him. And he's the one who's the faithful one. We are sons of Abraham, the Pharisees wanted to say, as a standing ground for them to be able to talk about their righteousness. And so James says, okay, let's talk about Abraham. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. So now you're getting Abraham, you're seeing the example that he had. Not only does James go to Abraham as this example of faith, but he goes to the most faithful time in Abraham's life, right? When he's offering up his son Isaac. So it's not just that, oh yeah, he kind of believed God here and he went here. Even in the most extreme situation when he didn't understand God, and had his own understanding about it, if you will, he still was willing to do all of this. And so it's saying that he had a faith. His faith was worked out in his actions. If he didn't believe God was going to do that, if he didn't believe God was righteous, he wouldn't have even started to offer up Isaac. We find out in the book of Hebrews, and it doesn't tell us this when we look into that, account in Genesis chapter 22, but when we look in the book of Hebrews in chapter 11, it tells us that there was something going on in Abraham's mind, and that was the belief that God could bring him back from the dead, some way, shape, or form. Didn't know it. We know that's not what happened, because in a sense it did. Abraham had kind of written off Isaac, but God had brought a ram for the offering there. So he was delivered in that sense. So you see, Abraham has this faith. He lives it out in such a way that it shows that he believed. And so he's giving us an example of someone who believes and acts on that belief. So much so that he says, you see, that faith was active along with its words, and faith was completed by his works. Now, this is not the idea that you have a faith and you need to slap some works onto it to make it real. The faith in itself is real. As if it's a true saving faith, it's real enough, and it will automatically show itself in works. There will have to be some sort of trust, some sort of dependence upon God in our lives when we have genuine faith. And so you see that faith was active, verse 22, along with the works, and faith was completed by his works. It wasn't the idea that Abraham, now he needs to do this, and finally he attains to a place of salvation. Remember back in Genesis chapter 15, now hopefully you guys are going through that in your Sunday school class, the idea that right then and there, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. But you see the idea of this righteousness being shown for what it truly is, in the sense that there's actions that are going to reflect it, okay? And I'll tell you just in a few minutes about that, okay? Here's what I mean here. In 1 John 4:12, it says, no one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. It's not that God's love isn't perfect at all. The idea of perfected there means that it reaches its intended goal. And so when we cite this thing, we're not saying, oh, God needs more of something else to add to his love to make it complete. It's the idea that when we love one another, we are living out God's intended purpose in our lives for love. And so that's the idea about Abraham here. When it says that his faith was completed by his works, that's the same word there. This word perfected means that it's reached its intended goal. Right? That Abraham, what was the intended goal? That Abraham would trust God no matter what. If God tells him to leave from a land where he grew up and his family was, and to go to a land that God would show him, Abraham would do that. It was a trust that God said, hey, I want you to trust me in this get circumcised here, have your family circumcised. I want you to trust me in this, that you would be willing to even offer to me this blessing that I gave you, Isaac, the son of your blessing, through whom all the blessings that are supposed to happen through him to all generations beyond and your mighty nations and all those things that were to come from you. Did you offer that up to me? You offer him up to me. And Abraham was willing to do that. It reached its intended purpose. It was completed by his works. That's the idea there. And so as we move into 23, and the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. And so we see this distinction of Abraham. You know, you don't see this a lot where God calls people his friend. Jesus called his disciples his friends. He said, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. And so we can say that we are friends with God now, but Abraham back then was different, right? And his faith was the same, but it was so much so that God calls him a friend. And there are a couple passages in Isaiah 41 and 2 Chronicles chapter 20. So now James has given this example about Abraham. He's saying, look it, Abraham believed, and this is what it looks like. Now he gives this other example. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. Oh, before we go to Rahab, here's the second part here. Here's a little distinction between how Paul and James use this word justified, okay? It's the Greek word dikao, and it means justified, okay? And so Paul here uses it, says, when in Romans 3:28, he says, for we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. So remember, as we're reading through this, and part of the reason why some of the scholars and the theologians have problems with this is because they're struggling with here, because it seems to say something that might be contradictory, but they're not really talking about things that are contradictory. Some people use the term, they're talking about two sides of the same coin, right? You look at a coin, oh, that's tails, that's tail. That's what a quarter looks like. It has an eagle on the back of it and all that sort of stuff. And then somebody else says, no. A quarter, it looks like it has, is that Washington's head on there? Right? It's got the bust or the head of Washington on there. No. And you realize they're talking about the same thing, right? So two sides of the same coin. Here it is. Paul says in Romans 3:28 what he says there, that for we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. What does James say? You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. Okay? So they're using the two words here. Now look at how they use them. Justify equals pronounced righteous in the sight of God. You can declare somebody justified. You can declare somebody righteous. Okay? So for instance, if you some people will come to me and they say, you are the pastor of Grace Bible Church, right? And then they might look at me and say, but you don't look like the pastor of Grace Bible Church. Okay? You know what I mean? It's kind of like you say, hey, you are this. You are the champions, right? But you don't look like champions. Okay? There are champions that are declared champions, and there are champions who look like champions, right? So here's what James is saying here as he uses it. He uses it as justified means prove righteous in the sight of others by the things that somebody has done. You can tell it. Somebody can call you a righteous person because you act righteously, but it doesn't necessarily mean that God has declared you righteous. And when I say that is because we know good people, right? We say they're good people. They seem to be kind people. They seem to be generous people. But maybe God is not in their lives at all. And we can look at their actions and we can say that they are righteous even though they may not have true righteousness, being declared righteous by God through his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. So here's how they're using it. Paul is using justified in the sense that somebody is pronounced righteous in the sight of God. James is saying somebody is proved righteous by their actions. Furthermore, I jumped two slides here. Paul says, that when you think about justified, it shows how an unbeliever becomes a Christian. This is what Paul is talking about when he's talking in Romans. This is the difference here. Because, you have people who are thinking, hey, if I do the works of the law and I do enough of those things, I can be righteous. Paul is saying, no, that's not true. Nobody by the law can be made righteous. They can only be made righteous because God declares them righteous. And the only way that somebody would be able to be declared righteous by God is to trust God for what he says he will do for them. And that means trusting him in his Son, Jesus Christ. So here it is. Paul shows how an unbeliever becomes a Christian. James is showing a believer how a believer lives as a Christian, how he maintains his fellowship with God. Paul is talking about here, when we talk about salvation and justification, he's emphasizing this root of salvation. God declares us righteous. James is saying he's emphasizing the fruit of salvation. So you got the root and you got the fruit. You guys come from ag background, you know exactly what that's like. Here, Paul, he stresses an inward position or disposition. We stand righteous before God. Correct? Are you guys following with me on this? So we come in to worship God here. He receives our worship of him, and it's agreeable to him. It's acceptable to him because why? We come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we've been washed of our sins. We've been made holy. We have holy standing with God because of what Christ has done, not because of what we've done. Right? Amen? Okay, just checking there, okay? And James is talking about our outward actions need to reflect this inward belief. Paul says it demonstrates God's part with human participation, okay? God's part with human participation and God declaring us righteous. James is talking about demonstrates a human part with God's help, you know? Because we have faith, we're living out our lives in a way that reflects the righteousness that God has given us. Verse 226 says, "For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." So as we went through that little slide there, and that wasn't mine originally. I got it from a commentary that I looked at there, but I think it sums it up pretty well. It's the idea that, did we talk about Rahab? I'm just going to go and touch on Rahab. Here's somebody, it's a Gentile woman. She believes God, and it's credited to her as righteousness. She shows how her belief in God shows out too, where she promises that, you know, because she believes the Israelites are going to come and that they're you know, her city can't stand. It's in the book of Joshua. You can go look it up. Can't stand against the Israelites, that she's willing to you know, protect them and lower them down and help the spies out as they come in, get ready to conquer the city. And she trusts that they will deliver her, and they do. And she actually ends up converting over, right? So this is Rahab. She is a righteous woman. I think the idea of using Abraham is because, sure, a Jewish people will look at Abraham, and he's the first, he's the top dog. And then you look at Rahab, here's this Gentile woman, and even she can have living, active faith, faith that is alive. Going to the last verse here, 26, "For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." When you break the two apart, all you have is death. Okay? All you have is death here. So faith apart from work is dead. Remember, as we looked back in there and we got back into James chapter 1 and we talked about what happens with temptation, but each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. We talked about that too, right? And so we're seeing, even in the lives of some of these people here, I mean, as people are coming in here and they're wondering, well, where's my faith? What, you know, what's going on? Maybe your faith is dead because it never had a root from which the fruit of works could grow. And if that's your case, if you get that, you want to get that right today, you can turn from your own way, receive forgiveness and saving in Jesus Christ. Maybe faith is dead because of surrender to temptation, as I just pointed to, bringing forth sin, which has put your life on the path of death. We talked about that a few weeks ago. You can repent of that as a believer too. Receive the forgiveness God promises to give us as we come to Him in Jesus' name. So this passage is difficult, yeah, because it challenges us in so many ways, but it's pretty straightforward as well. And the idea is that we have faith that is alive. It's a faith that is in a God who saves. It's a faith that takes action. It's a faith that is inseparable from works or deeds, okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this passage of Scripture. I pray that as your word has gone out, Lord, that it would do the work in our lives as you intended, for your glory, in Christ's name. Amen.
You are holy, you are faithful, you are Savior, you are friend. You are all I've ever need, Lord, you are. You are every question's answer. You are every reason why. You are moving, you are still, Lord, you are. You are the Lord on high. You on earth. You are Alpha and Omega.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now as you leave this place. Amen. You are dismissed.